Oh, you are into the last Fireside Chat. Would love to welcome on stage John Wicklein, Senior Director of Information Management at Gogo, and he will be interviewed by Jana Eggers, CEO of NaraLogics. Please give them a warm, warm welcome.
So we are in the awesome position of being between these guys and drinks.
This is true. This is true.
So, but we're also in a great position because you guys just talked about booking flights. And what we're going to talk about is the most important part of your flight experience, which is internet access. You all know who Gogo is, people who's used in-flight internet. Yeah, most people have. So John is responsible for machine learning, data analytics, at Gogo. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what that means to Gogo?
Sure. So Gogo focuses on a lot of different things, right, relative to the in-flight experience. And a little bit about Gogo, just to give a little more background. Obviously, you guys are familiar with us from the perspective of in-flight connectivity. We also provide other products, Gogo Vision, which is TV and movies, streaming television now as well, IPTV, all on your personal electronic devices. So for Gogo, a lot of what we focus on is obviously structured data. We have a lot of structured data like most corporations, but we have a large amount of unstructured data. In some companies, you'll note that they can run most of their business off of structured data, and the unstructured data just gives them additional insights. Gogo's a little bit more unique in that the unstructured data is essentially a critical part of the information we need to assess the operations of the service, et cetera. So for us, it's definitely the two types of data go hand in hand. And so a lot of our focus has been on, at least the last couple of years, is essentially getting all of that data into one common place and making it easy to enable analytics along with machine learning, artificial intelligence, et cetera.
Yeah, so let's go back those 2 years. So you've just done a migration over those last 2 years to
Correct.
AWS to help enable some of the AI that we'll also talk about a bit. But let's go back those 2 years and talk about what made you even start.
Sure. So a little history. So we started out with our structured data essentially in a SQL Server environment. And then we had a log file data we had to deal with. And at the time, this is probably about 5 years or so ago, one of the best ways we had to deal with it, at least that we developed, was to have Perl scripts that basically extract and parse out large volumes of this unstructured data, and we write it into this massive Oracle database. And then Hadoop technology came out, and we said, okay, good, let's move to Hadoop. Everything's in a file system now. And so we're like, very excited about that. We can deal with larger volumes of data. We could expand, et cetera. And we're like, yay, Hadoop. And then we realized that part of the challenge we had is that we need to see our structured data next to our unstructured data. And I'll give you an example. So let's say I have a flight, and I want to know everything that's going on that flight. I want to know how many sessions there are in flight connectivity sessions, how many video views there are, how much we have in sales, are there chats, how many visits do we have to the actual portal page. All of that is structured data. If I wanted to know, at least for Gogo, if I wanted to know what was the system availability and the latency and the ping times and the health of the service, et cetera, that is essentially a lot of it, and especially once we get deeper into it, is in the unstructured data. So we had to go over here to our Hadoop cluster to get the unstructured, here to our SQL Server environment to get the structured, and you either had to merge them locally in the reporting layer, or you could take an aggregate from the Hadoop layer and then push it over into your database and then SQL Server database and do that. So that was the fundamental problem we had. So the next thing we did was we migrated to AWS and used S3 Simple Storage Service to essentially combine all the data into one environment. And we did this in connection with Gogo's larger move to the cloud with the rest of IT initiated, and we gladly went ahead and followed. And so now we essentially have all the data in one nice common place, and then we can do our analytics, data science, et cetera, just on that set of data.
So let's talk about some of those use cases, because I do think it was very interesting as we talked before this. how much you have to deal with that. You know, you say unstructured data and it sort of sounds like, oh, it's always the same kind, but you have equipment that you have to deal with and the different carriers that you have to deal with. So you're managing different partners, not just, hey, there's, you know, electricity we have to turn on. You have a lot of different factors that you're trying to
Correct. A very good point. The fun thing, and I will say this, a little plug for working at Gogo. The fun thing about Gogo, and I came from a telecom background before, but the fun thing about Gogo is it's multiple industries in one. It's telecom, cellular, it's satellite communications, it's aviation, and it's a little bit e-commerce all in one. And so it creates a fun environment, but it means you do, to your point, have a large number of data sources. And what's interesting is when you look at the operational data that we're talking about, part of the information is you need to understand how the health of the aircraft is as it flies across the sky. And the best way to get the information is through the link that we provide ourselves and to our customers. And so we're very careful to only send a very small amount of information across the link that the customers leverage as well. And this is basically light ping information that tells us if the service is up and running or not. But we collect a much larger volume of data. All of the Gogo-equipped aircraft have a server that sits on board, and it contains a myriad of information. And I'll use fan speed as an example. So we have a server that sits in the aircraft that provides all the services. And it's like any server, it gets hot, so it has to have a fan to cool it. And so one of the variables that we store is fan speed. And that can be used to identify some cases where if the fan starts to slow down, the server may be getting older, may be getting hotter, let's do some preventive maintenance. The reason I cite this example is, this is a good example of data that we collect, but we don't need to send down to the ground every 5 seconds because we don't care what the fan speed was every inch along the way. But we do offload it once we get to the ground. So the aircraft lands, we use a terrestrial modem, we use cellular terrestrial network to offload that data, those large log files, and then do that initial analysis. And we have many use cases specifically for that data to help drive operational performance around the equipment and the aircraft and what steps we want to take with those.
And I think that's one of the interesting aspect is the quality of service, right? And you all have to deal with so many different factors and many factors you don't control.
Correct.
Like that airplane could be hot for a reason that has nothing to do with you and the fan speed matters, but you have to take into account, well, that's not really my equipment, that just happened on that one flight.
Correct.
And so that's one of the things that you're looking at and from my understanding from what you said, and if you could tell us a little bit more about that for the machine learning, is you were looking at when do we pull equipment because that interrupts your customers.
Correct, yeah, and just to finish off your point about various factors, weather is another example of factor. So, you know, I know we've seen some cases where you're in a heavy, heavy tropical climate with a lot of rainstorms, so you will get some interference with satellite signals, and these are things we've had to work through as well. But when we talk about equipment, and I'll just kind of transition into some machine learning. So let's take a problem. So we have a server that's aboard an aircraft. We have a lot of other hardware and equipment as well, antenna, WAPs, wiring, a bunch of other aspects as well. But let's just talk about the server as an example. So today, let's say that that server is having a problem. It reset a couple times, and it impacted some customer performance. So we have an operations personnel who gets information on that and then basically makes a decision. And the decision is, do I pull the server and swap it out with a new replacement? Do I let it go when it fixes itself, when it reboots potentially overnight or between flights? And so today, we found that more often than we'd like in some cases, we'll wind up pulling that equipment, which then involves cost because you have to actually have someone pull it, you have to take it back to a facility, and you have to diagnose the actual hardware. And we've had some cases where we've said, look, we pulled the equipment and it works fine. That wasn't the problem, must be something else. And so what we wanted to do was leverage data to get a much better sense of what's going on and have a more appropriate decision tree for the individual operations folks to go through and then make their assessments. And so what we've done, now that we have all this data in one place, is we've essentially set up a Bayesian network. By show of hands, Bayesian network. Okay, that's fine, because 3 weeks ago, I wouldn't be raising my hand to know what a Bayesian network is either. So as a disclaimer too, my background isn't necessarily as strong in the data science side, it's more in the data integration, data engineering, et cetera. So essentially, with this Bayesian network, it looks at a series of variables, and what we've done is we've taken our historical data over time, and we've said, you know, what factors are most likely to be predictors of a failure of equipment, and then what actually tells us that either A, we should pull the box that's on the aircraft and replace it with something else, or B, let it go, let it reset, or C, it's some other piece of equipment. And so we have a whole, like I said, a whole variety of data, system availability of the service, how many users were there, what was the latency of the service at the time, how is the communication between the WAPs in the aircraft and the server itself, where was the aircraft flying, what was the ambient air temperature, et cetera. And so we could take all this information, and essentially we use it to create a decision tree for folks on the ground who then say, okay, I have this event that's occurred on this aircraft, on this particular server, and here are the steps that I should take based off of this machine learning algorithm. And so that's the first part. And then the second part is, and the machine learning part really is, we then, let's say we've now been running this machine learning algorithm for a while, we then look at the results. So if the instances where it says pull the box and take a look at it, and we look at those boxes and it turns out that there's nothing wrong with these boxes, then essentially that input goes back into the Bayesian network and informs it to change its conditional variable weighting so it doesn't actually weight those factors as much because it was clearly wrong in those particular cases. And the inverse would be true as well. And so for us, this opens up a huge range of possibilities and how we can more effectively troubleshoot the rare equipment failures that we do have. So whether they be services on the aircraft, an antenna, WAPs, which are on board the aircraft, or one of the many other physical hardware components.
So as you talked about that, you talked about trying different ways of approaching the problem and seeing which. How did you all think about that, or did you think about that with the migration to AWS? I mean, I know you said your IT department was going to AWS, so that made it easier.
Right.
But did you worry, wow, if we got there, we wouldn't have tools that we'd have maybe at one of the other cloud providers?
Yeah, no, it's a good question. So I will say, you know, it's you know, we have a lot of decisions, at least in my area, that we have to make, and I'm sure other parts of the organization. But for us, the biggest advantage of being more on the data warehouse side is we tend to be in the tail end of the decision on IT, in the sense that we'd prefer to be near our data sources. And the reality is that's just where we generally like to co-locate. Can't be near all of them, but we generally want to be near many. And we actually had a fairly forward-thinking senior vice president of IT at the time who pushed us more the cloud direction. And he had some experience with AWS. I wasn't actually privy to more the specific decisioning behind AWS versus, say, Azure or a Google Cloud. But I will say that, you know, we're fairly happy with what we've done to move to them. We feel like the support level is very high. And Google Cloud and Azure have very good offerings as well. We just haven't fully explored those at this point in time. But for us, once we got to AWS, you know, the ability to have to leverage their S3 environment to have data co-located, we leverage Kinesis to handle large data and bundle it into more manageable chunks as well. It's been very effective for us. And then just there's the inherent benefits of having a cloud-based provider. I mean, if I had, over my career prior to going to the cloud, at least once a month something had happened somewhere in infrastructure with a Unix upgrade or you know, a server went down or a storage failure or something along those lines. So just the uptime alone of going to the cloud, whether it be in AWS, Azure, or anyone else, has been very, very effective for us.
So going to the cloud, bringing all the data together, and this has come up several times during the conference with other folks, is talking some about governance and the access, because in some senses there was a fair amount of that data before that was ring-fenced and that it was only on one person's machine.
Sure.
They were the ones who accessed those log files and did that. Now more people have access. You have GDPR, and so do you want to talk about some of that and how that's made you think about what you try to accomplish?
Yeah, I mean, I could talk a little bit about on the GDPR side specifically and the data governance side. So for us, for GDPR, obviously the organization has a lot of requirements that they can and can't do with certain aspects of the data. You have a right to be forgotten, for instance, and there's various parts of IT that have handled that. On my particular area on the data side, we're much more concerned about once we have data in the data warehouse, we have to obscure it properly, right? For those, you know, who operate more in the data-specific space, some of the challenges you have, and I should mention, we have a dimensional data warehouse. So you have certain dimensions that go across many things. And so one of them that's very useful is the Mac ID, for instance. So each device has a physical Mac ID. And so we're in a situation now where you know, internally we felt like, based on GDPR guidelines, we can't really store the Mac ID, and you can't really use it. And so we have to hash that. But some of the challenge is that if you hash and salt Mac IDs across the board, then you can't join between your data structures because you can't identify the same Mac from one environment to the next. And so we had to take a different approach to deal with that. So it's, you know, and from a data side, the funny thing about GDPR is you look at it and you say, like, it's, you know, there's not much value that we derive from implementing GDPR. It's just something that you legally have to do. And obviously it's in the customer's long-term best interests. Otherwise the EU wouldn't have adopted it, certainly. But it did present a challenge on our side, and it's something we worked through. But for most of the part, the focus for us was more on just obscuration of data, and then obviously in other parts of IT, establishing the mechanisms to enable folks to be forgotten.
So I just learned, actually, that Gogo, your inaugural internet flight was just a couple of days ago. I think it was August 20th.
Yes.
10 years ago. It's hard to imagine, right, that was, in some senses I was like, wow, 10 years seems so long, and the others I was like, wow, it's only been 10 years. So I think that's, the internet warps our mind in that sense. But I'm curious, how far back, that's been another discussion that I've heard from people. Some people said, I just started and went forward with the data that I had, and you guys have so much. Did you think about that? Did you think about, do we go back 8 years and look at data? Do we just stay with the last two?
It's a good question. And if you look at, you know, particularly in our area, the volumes of data growth are exponential. So if I look back in, you know, 2018 may have as much data as the prior 7 years combined, right? So it just keeps going exponential. So when we look at our modeling, we definitely go back quite a ways. What's interesting to Gogo is seasonality as well, weather events. So obviously winters and summers and other events have different impacts on the service. So in order to get a good statistically significant sample to look at, you have to go back many, many years in some cases. And there's, like you said, there's a lot of variables. So we have various technologies we use to deliver service. Some is cellular, some is satellite. Different configurations of aircraft, both on the business aviation side, which we haven't talked about too much, and on the commercial aviation side as well. So there's a lot of variables to look at. So definitely we'd like to go back as far as possible. But one thing we're also starting to look at too is, and going to the cloud, it gives you this visibility of how much you're spending on certain things. And you know, like many organizations have gone to the cloud, you know, we're very excited we go to the cloud. And then after a while, like, okay, let's look at cloud health, which is AWS's cloud health product that tells you about the various ways you're spending money. And we're like, why are we spending so much money to store data? And we look at all this stuff, and then it's, we start to ask ourselves, you know, do we, you know, is it worth keeping that, you know, 2012, 2013 data in S3 and paying the monthly fees associated with it? Is it that valuable for the analysis? And by the way, as soon as you talk to the data scientists, they're like, yes, of course it is, leave me alone. Right. Do not bother me with these concerns.
Storage is cheap.
Storage is cheap, right. And then you're like, that's nice, but it does add up. And the more you run these queries, you hit the S3 API cost as well. Please stop doing that so often. So, you know, from a data manager side, you have a different perspective than data scientist. But certainly we work together and ensure that we're able to move the organization forward.
So speaking of size of data, and you've mentioned weather a few times, there's also, and this has come up several times again too, about augmenting data. So do you get the weather data from the plane and so you don't have to worry about augmenting it, or do you have other places where you have to bring in
so
data from outside?
That's an excellent question, and it's one that we're actually just talking about right now. So some information you do get from aircraft. It depends on the particular aircraft and the type of configuration they have, and so we do have that information. Some of it you get from third-party providers. So sometimes you're going to want to know weather on the ground. So increasingly, Gogo has an offering with certain partners where we provide gate-to-gate service. So traditionally, in our cellular-based network, and probably the beginning stages of our satellite network, you're only allowed to enable the IFC, the in-flight connectivity service, above 10,000 feet. Many airlines now in the U.S. as well allows gate-to-gate service. So using Gogo as an example, if you fly on Delta using their 2KU service, a large number of their flights are gate-to-gate enabled, so you can leverage the service at the gate and up in the air as well. So getting weather information at airports is also very helpful to us as well, because certainly with the antenna sitting atop the aircraft, if you have large amounts of weather interference, it could impact the signal. And so we want to understand the impact of that. So third-party weather data, something we do have. We do get some from the aircraft as well, and always looking to expand upon that.
Is there other augmenting data that you guys think about that's important?
It's funny. So there are some things we've talked about. To be honest, so much of the focus and the low-hanging fruit for us is just leveraging our own data even further to help drive value, which is probably a use case that many folks in the audience see as well, I'm sure.
That's actually one of the reasons why I asked you is that I always tell our customers, they talk about, oh, we don't have enough data. I'm like, I promise you have enough data.
Yeah.
But you're not using what you have, and so people aren't used to thinking of it in the way of, look how much we can pull out. They
sure.
They just look at the log file, and I'm like, there's like 20 different ways to look at
absolutely.
That log file.
Absolutely. I mean, and just we could spend the next 10 years just looking at the data we have right now. So
we're gonna let you guys drink before 10 years.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
So it's definitely we're much more focused on our data, but when needed, we will augment, obviously.
Great. I think we'll break for questions, and you guys don't be shy just because there's drinks waiting, like we said. Did I mention the drinks waiting? But if you can raise your hand and wait for the microphone, it helps make sure that we have the questions recorded as well. Any questions? People are ready just to get on your flight, and we've got a question. Thank you.
Curious, in your move to AWS, did you move to serverless and Lambda and DynamoDB, or is it server-based?
Yeah, so I'll give you kind of a quick overview of architecture. So we leverage most of where what we leverage is EMR EC2 clusters, so all virtual clusters, to essentially do a lot of the data integration. We use Lambda functions to ingest. In some cases, if we can't figure out why it takes us more than 5 minutes to extract the data, because Lambda functions only allow a certain amount of time, we'll set up an EC2 cluster and just pull the data in. We have Kinesis running through to bundle the data into more manageable chunks. We use Dynamo more for automated balance of control, so we understand when the data comes in, and we use it also to we use Airflow for orchestration to essentially trigger off of what gets updated in Dynamo, and then we just store it in S3. So that's essentially our configuration. The unstructured data comes a little bit differently than the structured data and how we handle it. We use more Scala parsers to parse the data. On the data integration side, we use more PySpark for data integration specifically. I hope that answers your question. I went a little bit deeper. Once you started asking an architecture question, I just started talking. So. Yeah.
Do we have any other questions? So I'm just going to go back and I'll finish it, and then we can all run to drinks, I promise. But I am, a lot of people here are in marketing, and that quality of service is something, I will say personally, I'm relieved when I get on a flight with Gogo. So I appreciate all the work that you're doing there. How do you, I understand how you can get into the, gosh, if we have to switch this out, these people are going to be angry, and
sure.
We better do it when it really needs to. How do you get your team really thinking about the customer, whether that's the airline or the end user? How do you bring that into
sure.
your team?
Yeah, I mean, I think it definitely starts from the top. So, at Gogo, we've had a renewed emphasis, particularly on operational focus to ensure the highest level of service available. And it's funny, sitting within the data space, I see the numbers routinely. Even yesterday, I looked and the system availability was in the very high 90s, which is fantastic. And so, essentially for us, it's just setting certain things as the highest requirements, which is, that the system is highly available, that it's fast, and that it provides a high level of service. Particularly with one of our new 2KU technology, which also provides a higher level of bandwidth to the aircraft, you can do a lot more activities. Streaming is very easily done. You can stream television now as well. You can handle a much larger volume of user load than we would have traditionally under our cellular network. So with that focus, we we're able to keep customers happy.
That's great.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you for having me.